Hello, church. Let's all, wherever and whenever you may be watching this, let's open our hearts together and lift our voices in worship. I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy.
Hope. Church. We miss being with you, of course. I was thinking back to last summer and how we were in the tent, and that was a different and somewhat hard experience for so many reasons, lots of logistics and craziness going on as we built our building. But this summer has a lot of craziness and hard times going on too. And so what I wouldn't give right now to be in that tent with all of you in this beautiful weather, being able to hear your voices and worship with you. But this is where we're at. And I was thinking back to our time in the tent and a song that we started to sing, which is this next song we're going to do called Bring an Awakening. And I think it's really interesting how in different times in our lives, what we're going through changes these prayers and what we really focus on. And I think this is the perfect song to be singing right now as we're just going through so many growing pains and just changing and growing. This is a song that I'm carrying with me, and I hope that you carry with you not only today as we sing it, but in the days to come, that we would just call on the Lord, that he would bring his power to make change, but also that we would partner with him for his glory to be set apart and to be that change that the world is seeking. And so I invite you to pray this along with us as we sing today.
We're Please join me in prayer. Good and gracious God, we come before you today in the midst of struggles, in the midst of chaos. So God, we pray that you would show your love tangibly to us today and in these coming weeks. God, we pray for healing for those who are sick, specifically with COVID, but with anything. We pray for peace for those people who need peace right now. We pray for wisdom for decision makers surrounding COVID and surrounding the racial injustices and the situations with that happening in this country right now. God, give your wisdom and give your discernment to people who need it at this moment. God, we thank you for the dads and the fathers and the father figures and the people who we've looked up to and have been there and have done well for us. God, we thank you for them, and we pray that they have a blessed Father's Day today. God, we pray all these things in your wonderful name. We love you. Amen. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Christ Church once again. My name is Nathan Miske. I'm the youth director here at Christ Church, as well as one of the vicars or pastors in training as well. We're in the midst of our lesson series, Making Change, and part of that, with last week, I actually got to talk about how giving is good, and that's one of the changes we can make during this time of chaos, during this time of crisis, is that giving is good. And even though we're not going to be able to physically pass the offering plate past you today, I consider this a virtual invitation for you to give. You can give in a number of ways. You can give online. It's probably the easiest way to give at our website, christchurchmequon.life. You can navigate to the giving page from there. You can also give by mailing in your gift as well. And we appreciate that because with your gifts, we're able to make changes in the world, and we're able to have an impact. So we appreciate your giving. We appreciate your continued generosity during this time, and we ask that you do make that change towards giving. If it's your first time worshiping with us online, though, we don't ask that you make a gift. The gift is instead that you came to join us online this morning, and we hope to see you next week online as well. We got a couple things going on this week. We even have some stuff at the building this week. How exciting is that? So Thursday night at 6:30, we're going to have our first of our weekly communion services. So there's going to be small, intimate gatherings specifically focused around the sacrament of Holy Communion. So if you want to join us for that, you can RSVP online. We'd love for you to RSVP just so we can know you're coming. We can plan for how many people to keep the social distancing and safety intact. But we'd love for you to join us for that so that we can just know how many people are coming, and we'd love for you to join us for that so you can receive that physical, tangible reminder of God's forgiveness and grace for you. We also have a fun community scavenger hunt opportunity on Friday. So that's going to be, we're going to meet at the building, do a little devotional time, and then we're going to have you get sent out. We're going to give you clues, and you're going to have to try to take some pictures of different areas, different places. It's going to be a super fun event. It's going to be a great opportunity for your family to do something on a Friday night. It's going to be a great opportunity to invite some of your friends, some of your neighbors to do that. So we'd love for you guys to join us. Everyone's invited for our community scavenger hunt Friday at 6:30. We're going to meet here at Christ Church at the building, and then go out from there. With the social distancing, though, one of the things we've been doing throughout these weeks is finding someone to text or call or engage in community with who maybe we might normally not engage with community. However, we're hoping that this one is maybe a little more normal for you because it is Father's Day today. So if you have a father figure in your life, we'd love for you to text them and wish them a happy Father's Day. And maybe tell them what they've meant to you. Maybe just ask how you can be praying for them. If you don't have a father figure in your life, that's okay. Maybe text someone who you know is a father. Text some other dad. Or just text someone who's had an impact on you, who's done something great for you. So we'd love for you to do that now, engage in that community right now. I'm going to join you in doing that, texting my dad, and then you can join me with that as well. Thank you for engaging in community with us here at Christ Church. I ask now that you take a look at the screen and watch this short video while we prepare to receive the message.
Hey, Christ Church. I'm Pastor Bob, lead pastor here at Christ Church. It is great to be with you today as we wrap up our series, Making Change. And also want to give a shout out to all the dads out there. Hopefully you're going to listen real good today because part of this is for you today. But we're going to be wrapping up this series, Making Change, which means, of course, next week we start a new series. It's called Ancient Prayers. I hope you're getting excited about that one. It's going to be our summer series, and it's going to be powerful. How do I know it's going to be powerful? Because we are going to look at some of the most powerful prayers in Scripture over the rest of the summer. And so we just absolutely know that's going to translate into our lives, into our prayer life. It's going to unleash God in a new way in our lives. So make sure that you're with us, tuning in, ancient prayers. And there's small groups that are going to go along with that. Hope you're getting into those experiences as we open up the campus again. And as Nathan shared, you know, we're opening up the campus, going to be here starting in worship. So you know what? If you've been missing that, you've been missing Sunday mornings, be here on Thursday night because we're back. We're back in the building. We're back building that relationship and also then getting into those small groups, rebuilding that relationship as we kind of ease our way in and build up to being back here on Sunday mornings. So for today, let's wrap up the series, Making Change. And each week, we've been looking at kind of key phrases to help us kind of center our thoughts. Today, we're going to talk about Tomorrow Matters. And over these weeks, we've had these little phrases that help us to go ahead and kind of center our thinking. And so we started out with less is more, right? Less of us, more of Christ. In our lives, just letting Him take over. Stress is bad. Just remembering that regardless of the situations we're in, both individually or as a country, that God loves us. We just need to remember that. God loves us. God cares for us. God values each one of us, right? And then last week, giving is good. And just a shout out to Vicar Nathan. Incredible. Good job in sharing the word with you last week. The importance of that radical generosity in our lives, especially in difficult times, to just lean into that faith and lean into that radical generosity, especially in those times of crisis and difficulty. And so today we carry it forward with Tomorrow Matters. And kind of central to each of these topics and each of these opportunities is understanding that when crisis comes, that crisis itself creates the opportunity for change. That when we're in a difficult situation, when we're in kind of a crisis situation, that the very nature of a crisis itself helps us to kind of take a step back and to be able to look at the situation, re-examine the priorities in our lives, and often that means stepping into significant changes in our lives. And that's true for us as individuals. I believe that's also true for us in terms of the crisis we're going through as a nation right now, whether that's the health crisis we're going through or whether it's the racial issues that we're facing as a nation, that these crises are huge opportunities for us to be able to just step back, re-examine, rethink, re-understand how God would design us, how God would have us be, and be able to step into some changes. And so today, Today we're going to kind of look at that theme of tomorrow matters, of being able to re-examine our lives in the midst of this situation and be able to think about, so what kind of impact is my life having that relates to tomorrow, right? That not only that we live in the power of the day, but also as we live in the power of the day, what kind of foundational things am I doing that's going to have a huge impact into tomorrow, especially the lives of those who come after me? Now, you may hear that this morning and say, as a Christ follower, well, wait a minute, Pastor, I thought you're always telling me that our future is secure, that God's got our tomorrow, and that God's already working in our tomorrow, and so we can just trust Him for our tomorrow. Yes, absolutely. That's right. God is already working in our tomorrow. We can trust Him for our tomorrow. Our eternity is secure. Absolutely. But that doesn't mean we ignore our role and our responsibility in impacting the lives of others for their tomorrow. We get kind of this juxtaposition of living totally and impactfully for today, but then also living for tomorrow in the Scripture. Let me take you through some things. First of all, you get Jesus in Matthew 6 saying, listen, deal with your worry of today, right? You don't have to worry in today, right? So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's troubles is enough for today. And so he's kind of centering us in and saying, listen, don't worry about tomorrow. Instead, just maximize the day, right? God's got your future, so just maximize the day. Or you get the Apostle Paul, Pastor Paul, he's teaching to the church at Ephesus saying, make the most of every opportunity in these evil days, right? Make the most of every day. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do, right? So every single day, we just step out, we step into the day, and we do everything we can in that day to do what the Lord wants us to do, to live out our faith openly and just step into the opportunities of what it means to be a Christ follower this day. Absolutely, we do that. That's why Paul says, therefore, because that's true, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially those in the family of faith. That's the day, right? In the day, as we live through the day, we maximize the day, we do everything we can for the Lord, we do take advantage of every opportunity we have in the midst of that day. But as we do that, we lean forward, conscious of what we do today impacts the lives of others for their tomorrow. There's a great lesson to us from King Solomon in the book of Proverbs. And remember, Solomon is this guy who asked for wisdom and God gave it to him, so he's like the smartest guy ever, right? He says, take a lesson from the ants, you lazy bones. Learn from their ways and become wise. Okay, anybody in your house want to be wise? Anybody in the room want to be wise? Raise your hand. We got some hands up in the back. Absolutely. We want to be wise. Okay, so here's what he's saying. If you want to be wise, okay, look at the ants and here's what you do. Though they have no prince or governor or ruler to make them work, they labor hard all summer gathering food for the what? For the winter. They're working hard in every day, maximizing the opportunity of every day, and yet they're conscious of and they lean forward looking to the reality of tomorrow. They understand what? Tomorrow matters. Tomorrow is important. And so as we maximize the day, as we live out our faith in today, we also lean forward conscious of the impact we can have into tomorrow. Now we can see this play out for the Apostle Paul as well. You can feel the transition here as we go through these verses where he's living in today, but he's leaning, looking forward into tomorrow. Here's what he says. This is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed. How often? Every day, right? In the present. Every day he's getting renewed and renewed. God is working in his life. His spirit is working in his life. He's getting renewed and empowered for every single day. But he says, for our present troubles are small and they won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. Do you feel and sense the transition he's starting to go through? He's dealing with today, he's maximizing today, and yet he's starting to keep his eyes looking forward. It becomes more clear. He says, so we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. He's living in the day, he's dealing with the day, he's maximizing the day, and yet his gaze, his view is leaning forward to what lies ahead, to the impact of tomorrow. He says, for the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. You see, we have the opportunity to not only maximize the days for the cause of Christ, but we have the opportunity to be able to lean forward and make an impact that will shape tomorrow. It will shape the reality of our world for tomorrow. It will shape the reality of other people's lives for tomorrow. It can shape even the eternity of somebody else for tomorrow. And so we maximize the day, but we keep our eyes looking and gazing and leaning forward, looking for tomorrow. Here's the truth. Here's the reality. Tomorrow really matters. Why? Because we look forward and understand in today we're creating a legacy that will impact tomorrow. We live in the day, we lead forward, because we know what we do in today will impact and leave a legacy for tomorrow. One of the guys that really captures that well was King David. And King David wrote many of the Psalms, and the Psalms we're going to look at here, these are Psalms that he wrote as he was older, and he had experienced tons of life, and so he starts reflecting now on his life and what's valuable and what's important. And so King David, in his reflecting, says, O God, you have taught me from my earliest childhood, and I constantly tell others about the wonderful things you do, right? So he grew up in faith, and he constantly told people as he went through his life about the incredible deeds, right? About this incredible God, right? And yet, look what he says. Now that I am old and gray, do not abandon me, O God. Let me proclaim your power to this new generation, your mighty miracles to all who come after me. What is David urgent about? He is urgent about tomorrow. He understands tomorrow matters. He understands there is a new generation that matters because they now will carry forward the gospel. They now will carry forward the truth about Christ. Now he says his years are piling up there and his hair is old and gray. You may notice just the color on your TV there, but you may notice my hair is kind of that color too, right? And I share this with David. I share an urgency for the next generation. That in our today, we have to do everything we can and lean forward so that we capture the next generation for the cause of Christ. David says, we will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about his power and his mighty wonders. As we maximize the day, we lean forward looking into tomorrow. We know tomorrow matters. We know that this next generation matters and that we need to capture them with the love of Christ, with the forgiveness of Christ, with the grace of Christ, with the power of Christ, and with the understanding to live in the footsteps of Christ. And when we do that, it will change tomorrow. It'll change our world. It'll change the outcomes of our next world tomorrow. So we live and we maximize the day, but we lean forward trying to capture the lives and hearts of those who come after us. What you do today makes an incredible difference in the lives of those who are tomorrow. But here's an equal truth. What you don't do today makes an equal impact in the lives of those who will come tomorrow. Do you hear that? What you don't do today, what you fail to do today, has an equal impact in the lives of those who come tomorrow. If you go into the book of Judges, you're going to hear one of the worst things that I think I can imagine, one of the worst things possible. And this is after the people of God are in the promised land. They've settled into the promised land. They got the vineyards going. They got the wells and everything's working. They're living in prosperity. And as they live in that prosperity, they forget to keep their eyes on tomorrow. And here's the outcome. After that generation died, another generation grew up who did not acknowledge the Lord or remember the mighty things he had done for Israel. Can you imagine? A whole generation who just didn't know, who didn't understand, who had no relationship with the living God. What you don't do today has significant impact in the lives of those who are tomorrow. That's why Jesus warns us. He says, yes, a person is a fool to share up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God. You see, he centers it into this experience of relationship. It's so easy for us to buy into the ways of the world. It's so easy for us to follow the values of the world and to spend our time gathering all that wealth that we can gather and working all those hours that we can work and doing everything we can to have the success that the world would try to lend to us. But at what expense? Relationship. And so, dads, you need to listen well today, because if that's where your life is headed and you're putting all your time and your energy over here in the values and the things of the world, then you are going to lose out for a next generation, and that means your kids. And so we need to refocus. We need to make a change. In the time of this crisis, step back, take a look, and say, wait a minute, what is most valuable? And the reality is, tomorrow matters. My kids' lives tomorrow matters. Their faith tomorrow matters. Why does it matter? Well, because it's their faith that is going to allow them to stand. Their faith is going to allow them to stand when they face the crises that they're going to face. You see, we always have this. In every generation, we will face different kinds of crises, as we face the crisis right now in our nation. What drives us through? What pulls us through? What gives us guidance? Our faith. Our faith is that which allows us to stand firm in the middle of whatever experience we have. I think it's pretty easy for us to agree today that our kids are going to face their own kind of crisis. And for a lot of us, we probably look at the kind of crisis they're going to face and think, wow, it's going to even be more significant than what we've gone through in our lives. And so how do our kids stand firm? Well, Paul would speak to a young Pastor Timothy, right? And Paul would encourage Timothy and say, well, listen, it's your faith that allows you to stand firm. He writes Timothy and he says, but you must remain faithful to the things you have been taught. See, young Pastor Timothy is out there. He's trying to be a pastor to a congregation. He's experiencing difficulty and challenges and pushback and some struggle. And what does Paul say? Paul says, Timothy, you got to just stand in your faith. You see, it's our faith that allows us to stand firm, to be able to get through the crisis. It's our faith that allows us to stand firm, to be able to push back on any of those temptations that try to take hold of us. It's our faith that allows us to stand firm. And in our faith, we stand firm not only in that faith of what we believe, but we stand firm in knowing that we are loved. Jesus promises that. Jesus says, when you obey my commandments, you remain where? You remain in my love. This we want for a new generation. Not only that they stand in faith, but that they stand surrounded by the love of Christ, that they never forget, that they always know, that they understand completely that they are loved and they are forgiven and they can stand in their generation. Tomorrow matters. The next generation matters. And what we do today or what we don't do today has a direct impact on what their faith is going to be or not be tomorrow. Well, how does this happen? Well, tomorrow matters because faith legacy is built on relationship. That at the core, it's about relationship. So Paul says to Timothy, listen, remain in that faith, right? The faith you've been taught. You know they're true. How do you know they're true? How do you know you can stand in this stuff? Because you know you can trust those who taught you. Paul points Timothy and he says, stand in that faith. How do you know you can? How do you know it's good? You know it's good because you know the people that brought it to you. You know the people that taught it to you. You know the people that sacrificed so that you could have this kind of relationship with Christ. Timothy, you can stand. Not only because you have this faith, but you know it's true because of the people who have gone before you. You see, our kids, look at us. And they learn from our own lives. That's why Solomon, that great wise guy, right, says, and this is the amplified version, kind of amplifying so you get it, a good name earned by honorable behavior, godly wisdom, moral courage, and personal integrity is more desirable than great riches. What's he telling you? Hey, that list, godly wisdom, moral courage, personal integrity, all of that is vital as you live out today, not just for yourself, but because tomorrow matters. And that's what the children and the next generation are looking at in us. For us to be able to live out that truth in our own lives. That's why Paul says to the Ephesians, he says, fathers, talking directly to dads here, you ready? Fathers, don't provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord. Now, it's kind of interesting when I share that verse often with dads, right? Right away, dads so often, they hear that verse and they'll jump right and say, yes, it's about that discipline. Yeah, well, actually, it's not just the discipline. Look what's following it. Bring them up with the discipline, yes, and what? Instruction that comes from the Lord. It's a both and. And here's what I've learned in my own life, right? This is my own personal experience with my kids. The more I instructed them and the more I had relationship with them in the Lord, right? The more I poured my faith into them, the more I shared my values and my biblical foundation with them, the more I poured out Jesus into their life through me in my own life, the less I had to discipline them. The more I gave time and energy and effort into that instruction in the Lord through a relationship of love with them, the less I had to step in to the discipline. Tomorrow matters. And our faith legacy is passed on by the power of our relationships. And that's not just to our children. It's the relationships of those around us, right? That's why as we come back on campus, we're saying get in a small group, get in a small group, get in a small group, right? That we start getting back in that relationship with one another first. And we build those relationships. We tell you all the time to get in a small group. Why? Because you may be exactly the person that God is going to use to pour some instruction and faith into somebody else who needs to hear it uniquely from you and from your life experience. Get into a group, not simply for yourself, but get into a group so you can pour yourself into the life of somebody else. And their tomorrow gets change. See, tomorrow matters. It absolutely matters. And it's built on our faith, and it's built on the Scripture. We're not talking about creating the gospel according to you here, right? We're talking about just pouring into those around you and into your kids this truth found in Scriptures. As Paul talked to this young pastor, Timothy, he says, you have been taught the Holy Scriptures. He stayed centered in the Holy Scriptures. Just share the word with others and share the word with your kids. Tomorrow really does matter. Now, there's one last thing I want to share with you. One last thing, one last key element as you look at your life and the changes that can be made in your life right now in the midst of this crisis, thinking about how tomorrow matters and this next generation matters. Make sure you pass on to your kids and to this next generation the power of faith in generosity. The power of faith in generosity. You see, Timothy learned his faith from his family, right? We know it says, I remember your genuine faith, for you share the faith that first filled your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. And I know that same faith continues strong in you. Timothy learned the faith from his mother and from his grandmother. They generously poured out their faith. And I suspect they taught him radical generosity so that he would pour out his faith and life into the lives of others. You want to change our world, you want to change our culture, you want to change tomorrow. Get serious about pouring yourself out in your faith in Jesus Christ to somebody else. And that means equally taking seriously radical generosity. Proverbs, Solomon again said, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. He leaves it how far? To his children's children. That's leaning into tomorrow. Now, I know there's a lot of you out there, some of you out there, who have already taken the incredible, radical, generous step of thinking about children's children, of thinking about Christ's church on way into the future, and you've made provision for Christ's church in your estate plans. If you haven't done that yet, I'm just going to be straightforward with you and say, I hope you do. I hope you do. Because tomorrow matters. And the next generation and the generation after that need to hear about Jesus Christ. They need to know the love of Christ. They need to know the forgiveness of Christ. They need to know the words and the deeds of Christ. They need to be able to know how they can step into the footsteps of Christ and continue to change the world. You see, tomorrow really matters. And what you do today impacts tomorrow. And what you don't do today impacts tomorrow. And so as you think about this crisis, as you think about your life right now, start thinking about the things you need to change. Things you need to change to make sure you make a statement in your life that says, not only does today matter for me, but tomorrow matters for the next generation. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you use us in every generation to carry the gospel, to share the truth about Jesus, and to make a difference. And Lord, we are in the middle of crisis, and it's in this crisis that you can work and make changes in our lives. And so we ask today, as we've gone through this series, that you would use these messages, use your word proclaimed to be able to just make that change real in our lives, that we can step into that change. And on this day, that we can step into making sure we not only use every day, but we keep in mind tomorrow, and that we step into making that difference for a new generation. Lord, I just pray Christ Church would always be that kind of place, that we would always be a place that not only values those who are here, but we value those who aren't here, not just in this day, but a generation to come. So we ask for your encouragement, your wisdom, and your strength in this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
We know that tomorrow matters. And one of the things that help us to make changes for our tomorrow is by knowing that we are forgiven today. And we get to do that through confession and absolution, because we know when we confess our sins before God and we hear the words we are forgiven and believe them, we are forgiven. So take a minute here to do just that, to confess your sins to God. We know that Jesus was given to die for us, for you. So hear now this, that through Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection, you are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Having been forgiven together, and having shared in this worship and this community together, let us now also share in praying together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hey, thank you for joining us here today at Christ Church. We have one more thing to lift up here, is that we have a prayer line for you. So if you're in need of prayer during this time, or if you just want prayer during this time of crisis and you're watching live on Sunday morning, you can go ahead and call on in right now to 262-243-3093. That is our Christ Church mainline number. Click option 7 right away so that you can be connected to a prayer partner. We have them standing by waiting, just anticipating being able to pray with you and for you for whatever is going on in your life that you would like prayer for. We also have a way to get involved with prayer through our prayer wall online. So if you're not watching live and you want to get involved in prayer, whether by needing a prayer request or to pray over someone else, visit our prayer wall on our website, christchurchmequon.life. You'll be able to navigate to our prayer wall there where you can receive prayer or be generous in praying over someone else as well. Band's going to stick around and play one last song for us, so we hope you stick around for that as well. But thank you for joining us this week today at Christ Church. We hope to see you Thursday for our communion service, and we hope to see you on Sunday night, next Sunday as well, for back online for regular worship here at Christ Church. Have a happy Father's Day, everyone.
Will you unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am
Blessed day. Enjoy your Father's Day, everyone. We'll see you next week.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I-